So friends, welcome to this lecture series on technology, society and politics. Today's lecture is titled "Technology is Political." So we are going to talk about how the idea of technology attains the significance of what may be called the political in our society. So friends, imagine that, political concepts are changing. Look around. Most of the political ideas, say liberty, equality, or rights, or democracy, constitution, no matter what, the theories, political theories or concepts, which we use to describe so many things around us, no longer exist. That our concepts which we use to describe the world around us no longer exist. We need new concepts and new ideas to talk about the things around us. What is the reason? The reason is that you just look around. Advances in genetic engineering, or advances in medical science, or advances in robotics, or nanotechnology, or artificial intelligence, they are going to change our life. They are going to change our world. We got the ability to edit our DNA so that our life can be changed. We are able to join with the machines. So we are going to adapt the non-human character of machines as our own character. So we are able to manufacture fresh new organs like a hand or a leg. We are going to manufacture tissues artificially. So we are able to personalize medical treatments for our own genetic makeup. So technology is going to change our world permanently, friends. Here we have to say something about technology, that when we say about technology as political, we have to keep in mind that the technology should be important and relevant to our community. All these technologies should be relevant and important to our community. For example, friends, in the 1970s, women's liberation movement tried to say that personal is political. In the 1970s, women's liberation movement tried to say that personal is political. And they were struggling to convince the world that everything personal is also political. So friends, in the same way, today we are at a juncture. We are at a critical juncture, and we are not able to convince the world that technology is political because most people won't understand what we are saying. But friends, we have to deduce that political concepts are ever changing. Political concepts are ever changing. In his book, The Age of Revolution, the book Age of Revolution, famous historian Eric Hobsbawm list some of the vocabularies that were invented between 1789 and 1848, a short span of time. That was just a historical inquiry of the emergence of new vocabularies in the English-speaking world. And he listed so many vocabularies relevant to political science or social sciences. For example, middle class. You are saying that middle class, the word middle class was a discovery of the, you know, 19th century. It was a 19th century vocabulary. Before 19th century, the world doesn't know anything about middle class or capitalism. Before 19th century, the world doesn't know anything about capitalism or socialism. Liberal, the word liberal, the word conservative. Friends, these are now everyday political vocabulary. But before 19th century, people don't know anything of these, you know, any of these words. Friends, you just look at the Oxford English Dictionary. In recent years, Oxford Dictionary added some new vocabularies relevant to political debates. For example, you may remember post-truth. You may remember fake news. These are politically relevant vocabularies. And why these vocabularies were added? Because technology has affected certain changes in our life. Therefore, in order to understand that, we have to invent new vocabularies. So, these vocabularies, when we say post-truth, post-truth is something related to vocabulary, sorry, technology. Or fake news is something related to technology. So, technology is changing that way. We have to redefine many of old concepts, political ideas and political concepts. So, for example, friends, in future, the very idea, the very crux of politics will change. What is the very crux of politics? That is power. Power is at the center of any political debate. And this very idea of power will change because technology is changing our world. You imagine, we are all political scientists or we are all political theorists in that sense, whether we like it or not. All of us are political theorists. It doesn't matter whether you are a practicing political scientist or you just studied political science or you have never studied political science. It doesn't matter. Because, you know, there is no such thing as value-free, neutral political concepts. All the vocabulary we use, you say, I need right, I need equality. When we say these kinds of, you know, utter these kinds of vocabularies, you are a political theorist. And you are using these words referring to the hard realities of your life. That somebody is saying that I need justice. I need right. You are saying this from the hard facts of your life. You are not talking from some abstract notions. So that, friends, here comes the significance of saying technology is political. Friends, technology will become political in the days to come. The power, the very notion of power in future will take three forms. That we say that we define politics as struggle for power. And from that perspective, friends, when we look at future, power will attain three very important forms. First one is power will take the form of force. Second is power will take the form of surveillance. In the last class, I talked about scrutiny. And third, power will take the form of perception control. Power will take the form of perception control. Why? Because technology is developing that way, in which we have to redefine the very notion of political power. Friends, in the days to come, imagine those of us who control the technologies of force, the technologies of surveillance, the technologies of perception control, will be more powerful. And correspondingly, those of us who do not possess any of these will become powerless. That is, the technologies of force, the technologies of scrutiny, the technologies of perception control, those of us who control these things will become powerful, and those of us who do not possess this will become powerless. And we need to know who will be powerful over whom in the days to come? Who will become more powerful in the days to come over whom? For example, you might remember Robert A. Dahl, American political scientist, famously saying, defining power as, A has power over B to the extent that he can get B to do something that B would not otherwise do. Clear? A has power over B to the extent that he can get B to do something that B would not otherwise do. Friends, this situation, this definition covers a variety of situations in our life. We can apply this definition to political scenario. We can apply this situation to technological scenario. Let us apply this Robert A. Dahl's definition of power to a technological scenario. You imagine, friends, all technology that we use run on software. And software is nothing but code. That's a certain kind of language which we don't know. Only computer experts know that language. So technology run on software, which is a type of language which we say code, C-O-D-E, code. Code consists of a series of instructions that the code is telling the hardware, your mobile, your computer, or your, you know, computer-enabled ceiling fan, or your computer-enabled refrigerator or air conditioner. This code is telling the particular device that it should behave in a particular way. That is code. It's a type of language, just like we are using Malayalam or Hindi or Tamil or English. It's a type of language. Code is written in a programming language. Just like say Malayalam or Hindi. It's an artificial language. We cannot understand it. Only machines can understand that language. And friends, the point with the code is that when you see code as a language, code is very precise. It is not possible to interpret the code used in a particular situation, in a particular software. But in natural language, we can interpret. So say somebody of you are saying that I need justice. So all the people in the world can interpret justice in their own way. But in the software, when a particular language is used, a particular code is used, nobody in the world can interpret that language or that particular code. That is, code is unambiguous. It's an unambiguous command. There is no room for interpretation. So code and algorithm, they are different, friends. They are different. Code and algorithm are different. Say, we are saying algorithm is describing a set of instructions. Algorithm is describing a set of instructions for performing a particular task or solving a problem. An algorithm need not to be written in a computer code. Computer code is a language. Algorithm is certain instructions to a machine to perform certain task. So when we talk about technology, algorithm is the formula. Code is the expression of that formula. Code is the expression of that formula. So what code and algorithm has to do with power? You just imagine what a code and algorithm has to do with power. So when we interact with the digital technologies, we are necessarily submitting our life to the dictate of a particular code of the software. For example, friends, you cannot access a password protected document unless you enter the correct password. Correct? Am I correct? You cannot access a particular password protected document unless you enter the correct password. For example, your Facebook account or your Gmail account. If you do not enter the correct password, Gmail will not allow you enter into your Gmail account. That means code has the ability to direct our behavior in a fine-tuned way. You cannot talk to your Gmail account and please help me, please open up the account. I am not able to enter the correct password. You cannot use any kind of sympathetic language there. You should definitely enter the correct password. So you don't have any kind of room for negotiation with the Gmail. And friends, that is why many writers like, you know, Lawrence Lessig, he is a Harvard professor of law. These kinds of people are saying that code itself is law. That is, computer language itself is a law. You have to treat computer language itself as a law. Or at least code is like a law. If you don't consider it as law, please consider code is like a law. Imagine that you are sending your friend an email containing a digital music that you have downloaded from iTunes, for example. That music file may well refuse to play on the computer of the friend. Why? Because that particular music file is copyright protected. That particular music file is copyright protected. A kind of force, a kind of power would prevent your friend from playing that music which you have shared with that friend. Imagine that iTunes, that's Apple company, part of it's a technology of the Apple company. iTunes did not actually prevent the friend from accessing the content. Rather, it is punishing that particular friend from trying to do so. If you try to enter a copyright protected material, the particular company will lock you from using that particular account for 24 hours or for a particular period of time. So that company itself is punishing you. If you knew this was going to happen, friends, you might think twice before downloading and sending the music file to your friend. And in this scenario, both you and your friend behave in a certain way because you fear punishment. And this punishment is not done by the state. This punishment is done by the particular software company. So punishment, which was once a repository of state, has been taken over by a private corporation. And friends, this is coercion rather than force, a type of coercion that you are prevented from doing something. Friends, the distinction between cyber and real is already losing its distinction for younger people like you. And you, I don't think you are going to distinguish between cyberspace and real space. When you say I'm chatting on WhatsApp, it means that you are simply chatting. It's not cyber chatting. In the days past, you know, when you say that I'm chatting means you are talking to someone in the physical space. But today, when you say that I'm chatting on WhatsApp, a couple of years ago, it means that you are cyber chatting. But there is no cyber chatting now, because chatting on WhatsApp has itself become a simply physical chatting. Or you say, you are buying some stuff on Amazon. You simply, in a couple of years ago, you would say, I am e-commercing. Now, there is no e-commerce, friends. Why? Because buying from Amazon has become just like you are going to a shop, a physical shop, and buying something from the store. So that, you know, we have stopped saying Amazon.com. Nobody these days say Amazon.com. We simply say Amazon because Amazon, the idea of Amazon has become a physical space. Actually, Amazon is an entity or an identity in the cyberspace. Amazon is an identity in the cyberspace. But that has no more, that has become no more an entity in the cyberspace. That has become a physical entity. So that we are not saying Amazon.com. That means, friends, code is surrounding us. The code of software is surrounding us everywhere. And those of us who have got control over that code, that particular language, is also able to control us. So this will profoundly affect the way we live in the days to come. And, you know, in a sense, technology will become force. Technology will become force. There is a shift in our life. There is a shift in our life from the law enforced by humans to the law enforced by digital systems. Friends, in the days past, state enforced the laws. But friends, today, in many areas of our life, we require no more the idea of state to enforce laws. In the past, the work of enforcing laws was mostly fell to people. It was the function of trained people to enforce laws. There was a state and it got so many personnel to enforce laws. And state had so many agencies, law enforcement agencies. Last couple of centuries, there was the arrival of a new class of law enforcement agencies. For example, right from the Enlightenment era. Last few centuries saw the emergence of law enforcement professionals. So now we have full-time professionals to implement law systematically and methodically. Foremost among these law enforcement agencies are police force. We have trained uniformed police force and trained armies. So the revolution in policing, the revolution in armies, was coupled with a revolution in policing. The judicial system in modern world is tasked with prosecuting and sentencing criminals. We are increasingly depending the services of judges, jurors, lawyers. But friends, in the future, digital technology will be able to do much of the work that our law enforcement agencies performed and humans have performed. Rule enforces rule. In the days to come, rules will enforce themselves. There is no more need for policing, no more need for investigating offices, no more need for prosecuting agencies, no need for judges, no need for juries. We have already automated all these activities. For example, friends, I can tell you some examples so that you will be able to understand how state become irrelevant. You just imagine the idea of automated speed cameras on our roads. Already our roads are full of speed detectors, speed detection cameras. So road safety is automated. Tracking traffic violation and punishment is already automated thereby. No traffic policing system is required anymore today. It would not be that long for the smart enforcement system automatically removes cash from your digital wallet for every 10 seconds you drive over speed limit, or fines you for every minute you spend parking illegally. It is not long that, friends, these things will happen. It is already happened some part of the world, in USA or in some European countries. Already these things have happened, because if you park your car illegally in a no parking zone, or you have already violated a speed limit in a particular road, the speed detection cameras have already tracked the violation and would have debited or withdrawn some amount as fee from your digital wallet. It is not that far. It is, these things have already happened. So we are already moving to that direction. So friends, that day we will realize that no more we require a traffic policing system. So state will disappear in that area. The role of the state will disappear in that area. So digital technology can perform roles traditionally associated with judiciary as well. Digital technology can perform roles traditionally associated with the security. So security and so many judicial activities are automated. Many functions traditionally performed by trained professionals of the state will be no more required. As more and more human activities falls to be undertaken by digital systems, digital enforcement will become a matter of necessity, not a convenience. Friends, today we think that automated speed detection cameras are a convenience. But friends, in the days to come, that will just become a necessity. Friends, here, digital law enforcement may seem a weird idea. But friends, it doesn't really disrupt our notion of what is law. Hans Kelsen, the famous Austrian jurist, who had written a mighty book, Pure Theory of Law, 1934. It was a 1934 book. Kelsen argued that law does not actually prohibit things. Law does not actually prohibit things. Law can be understood this way, that you are doing something. That action is not permissible by the law of the state. Then the state thinks that you have acted against the will of the state. You have acted against the will of the state. So notice that you violated a traffic law, or you killed someone, or you have stolen something from somebody. So the state considers that you are an enemy of the state. So state naturally punishes you. So according to law, you are not supposed to do that. If certain conduct is performed, an official of the state should apply some sanctions on the doer. So those who committed a crime, those who killed, those who have broken a law, an official of the state apply some sanction on the doer. That is law. So H.L.A. Hart, who was a famous writer on law, He says like this, there is no law prohibiting murder. No law is prohibiting murder. Rather, law is giving you punishment for murder. There is only a law directing the officials of the state to apply certain sanctions in certain circumstances to those of us who have committed a murder or a theft or overspeeding a car. So there is no law prohibiting wrongdoing in the digital world. Similarly, there is only law in the form of code. There is only law in the form of code. So this code is directing the digital system to apply certain sanctions in certain circumstances to those of us who commit a wrongdoing. So for example, if you send an obscene content to someone, the service provider will block your account for some time. If you download a copyrighted material or watch or read a file that is copy protected, your account will be suspended for a particular point of time. It is technologically doable. Technology by default does this. Previously, this function was performed by the state. Now it is done by the digital system. So the burden of the state is reduced. Imagine a self-driving car. It's a code. Self-driving car is a code. It is set in that way, it cannot drive over a particular speed limit at all. If you set the code of the car, that self-driving car, in which the car is not able to overspeed after a particular speed limit. So, friends, then the idea of speed detection by the police force does not exist at all, because your car by default cannot overspeed because its code is set that way. Some of the functions of the state will be removed. So instead of thinking about finding such people who are overspeeding, we can simply avoid the very concept of overspeeding and finding overspeed. So many roles performed by the state will no more exist in the digital systems. You will never be fined for parking illegally. Why? Because the car itself wouldn't let you do so. The sensors of the car identify signals, no parking signals, and it will never allow you park in a no parking zone. So fining drivers for parking car in no park zone will be removed. That idea will be removed. You wouldn't be able to trespass on a property because the GPS system in that property, no matter what it is, there will be GPS system attached to that particular property, and the GPS system know that it's a private property and belongs to a particular owner. So you imagine you have stolen a mobile. So the code of the mobile knows that it is owned by someone who is not its real owner. Then the machine will never function, friends. This machine will never respond to your commands, because the machine identifies that you are not the real owner. So its code is set that way. Only the real owner can operate it. Friends, then the very idea of, theft is removed. The very idea of theft, stealing something from someone, that idea is removed because of digital system. Or you imagine, the very idea of state punishing you for theft is removed. The role of judiciary is reduced. The role of the police force is reduced. Role of the state itself is, reduced. That scenario is not so far, friends. We are very close to that situation. You couldn't use your car to run down pedestrians in a terrorist attack. So Salman Khan would not have been punished for killing pedestrians. or you know, it's the code of the car is set that way. The machine self-directs not to hit on human pedestrians because the sensors in the car detect that there are pedestrians and the car should not hit them. So no matter how hard you try to drive your car and hit on the pedestrians, you won't be permitted to do that by your car because the code of that car is set that way. So you cannot use the car for terrorist or illegal activities. So it's punishing you for running on pedestrians. That very idea will be removed. And judiciary will not have any role in that area. State will not have any role in that area. Police forces will not have any role in that area. There will be no law at all to interfere in such a situation because we don't need law for that. Such scenario is not far. Your car is coded that way. It recognizes emergency vehicles such as ambulance and fire trucks. It is coming. So the car stops itself. Even if you wanted the car should move on, but you can't because the sensors and the GPS systems in the car is set that way, it will stop when an emergency vehicle is coming or an ambulance is coming. So the car pulls over to let the ambulance pass. So the crime and punishment for not giving way to an emergency vehicle is taken away from the very coffers of the state. State need not to interfere in such areas. Your car also is programmed to stop for the police, for example. Irrespective of whether you wish or not, the car stops automatically for the police. The vehicle won't drive over a certain speed. So this idea, these are not strange or weird ideas, friends. This is already, you know, in under the pipeline. By and large, we are free today to break laws. We are free today to break laws. But we are deterred from doing so because the threat of punishment. So we won't, steal or we won't break a law. Why? Because we fear punishment. And officials of the state rarely force us not to break the law. They will come to your home and will tell you that you should not break this law or that law. That is not the way law enforcement is done in our society. And also the law enforcement agencies and the state don't know that whether you break a law or not. But we will never commit a law breaking because we fear punishment. The punishment is the idea that prevents us from breaking laws. If there were no punishment, we will all commit wrong. But friends, you imagine we have already shifted from law enforced by people to a law enforced by technology. It means that power will increasingly lie in force rather than coercion. With the self-enforcing laws that cannot be broken because they are encoded into the world around us. The idea of state in future will look entirely different. You think about DRM technology, for example. DRM technology means digital rights management. It's a growing technology, friends. It is a way of protecting copyright for digital media. In finance, we literally can't withdraw money from a bank account after it is frozen, right? When your account is frozen, you cannot withdraw your money from a bank account because the bank software prevents you from withdrawing money. That is called DRM technology. The technology already exists for smart guns. What is smart gun? The smart guns are operated by biometric sensors. You can shoot your gun only when the biometric sensors identify that the fingers on the trigger is your hands, that is a scanned hands, the scanned fingers, or the legitimate owner. If stolen or traded illegally, the smart guns never function, and this weapon is useless. Well, my mobile itself is biometric protector. You can see there is a biometric protection, and only I can open this mobile. If it is stolen, nobody can open this because it is biometric protected. So only my fingers can open this. There is no screen lock, or there is no number system. It's only biometric or protected mobile. So nobody in the world can use my mobile. So that way, you know, technology is growing, and when it is growing, you know, many roles traditionally associated with the idea of state will be you know, taken away, will disappear. Friends, along with this, there is another problem. What is that? Privatization of power. Power is going to be privatized. So we teach in our political science class that, with some exceptions, only the state is the body entitled to use force against people. Only state is legitimized to use force against people. But you think about technologies. The most advanced technologies, such as artificial intelligence. Friends, state does not possess this technology. No state agencies possess this technology. Artificial intelligence as a technology is developed in the lab of private agencies. Say Google. AI has developed by Google. Facebook has developed its own Google. AI. Amazon has developed its own AI. Google has developed its own AI, artificial intelligence. Friends, the state of the art technologies remain with the private enterprises, not with the state. State has no technology. State has no knowledge. Not any national government in the world, or even a university. Even a university doesn't possess any of these technologies, friends. And it is said that there is a technology in Google that is called X. They call it X. That X technology is a technology. That's a secret technology. It is said it's a conspiracy theory. Nobody knows it. It's with Google. It's a secret lab facility in Google. I don't know exactly. I have read it from some books. That technology is that Google is researching on, extending life expectancy. It's a secret, research, and Google didn't reveal anything about this research facility, and they codenamed it as X. And so many very advanced and also dangerous technologies are under research, and nobody knows what it is. And one of the technology they are investing capital and research, R&D, research and design, is, you know, increasing, you know, life expectancy. It's a technology Google are very fond of. But anyway, friends, these technologies remain not with the state, but with private agencies. That means, friends, private enterprises or private capital is increasingly possess power. The state of the art technologies remain with the private capital. The corporations reside inside the state. The private capital reside inside the state. Of course, they are subject to the laws of the state. They may be required to use their technologies. So, but friends, they may cooperate and they may comply with the laws of the state, but they are very powerful. You know, private capital is very powerful. And in the days to come, friends, there is another area of, you know, technology called surveillance technology. And state doesn't possess any surveillance technology. Surveillance technologies are developed by private capital. That Facebook is looking into your privacy. That Google is looking into your privacy. Twitter, YouTube, everything, everybody, all these technologies are looking into our privacy. And they know many things. They know many things about you. And as I told you in the previous lecture, knowing something about someone is a way of controlling them. So in the days to come, surveillance will increase. When surveillance will increase, the entity which is able to collect so many data about us will be able to control us. So it will control us, you know, in way of, you know, physical force. They can coerce you. They are also able to exert perception control. Perception control. What is perception control? Perception control is the idea that an outsider can exert power over people without subjecting them to force or coercion. How is it possible? It is possible through controlling what you know, what you think, what you are prepared to say about the world. So it is possible by convincing you that you should not think that way. You should not desire that thing. That thing is, you know, shameful. By way of convincing you that you should not think that way, that means technology has grown up that way in which your thinking ability is being controlled by those who possess technology. It's a dangerous scenario. Friends, in the past, news media were able to control you because you are reading news from broadcasting, you know, entities, that the print media owner can control your thought. The television can control your thought. Nowadays, it is not done by news media. Rather, it is done by big technological firms. Friends, these days, big corporations are broadcasting information to millions of people. In that way, what you read, what you see, and what you think are controlled by these corporations. And you just look upon your Facebook timeline, for example. If you read a Wire News article, algorithm in Facebook is thinking that you love to read news. Then the algorithm automatically filter so many news on your timeline. Suppose you are searching about film actors. The algorithm in Facebook think that, or YouTube think that, or Twitter think that, or Google search think that you love to read so many things about film. So it automatically by default giving you so many information about film world on your timeline. So what you read, what you see, what you think is shaped by these technological firms that has grown bigger than the stage. So every time algorithm chooses which news story to tell you, what search results to prioritize for you. So friends, for tech firms, code is power. We know that state doesn't possess any of these technologies. State doesn't possess technology to gather data from its citizen. And as of now, government of India, for example, has, this Aadhaar, that they know our eyes and also our, you know, biometrics. And they have our photo. Government has our photo. More than that, government of India doesn't possess any other, you know, vital information about us. They know our caste and they know our education status, etc., etc. But friends, Facebook knows more than that. Google knows more than that. YouTube knows more than that about you, because they know what you think, what you like, what you dislike, what you are, what is your ambition, because that is in their search history. In that way, you know, these technological firms have grown more powerful than the state. So in the days to come, friends, business firms enjoy the power of scrutiny, the power of perception control, the power of scrutiny. They are able to surveil you, they are able to exert perception control. So the tech firms will possess real power. They will possess real power, far greater than, you know, state. You know, they will have wide-ranging capacities. Private firms, technology firms will have wide-ranging capacities to get others to do things which you would not otherwise do, that I told you about. They have power over things which we would not otherwise do. Robert Edal's famous definition of power. Friends, this is applicable to tech firms. Tech firms are able to do, to get you do things which you would not otherwise do. So that's why, friends, some writers compare mega companies like Google to a government or a state. But anyway, some other writers say that this idea is sloppy. This kind of comparison is sloppy, because a tech firm is, after all, a private firm. It operates in a market system. It is not answerable to the public. State is answerable to the public. And a private firm has its own interest. But the state, on the contrary, do not have its own interest. It represents the interest of all the people inhabiting in that state. In theory, at least, state exists for all of us. Private companies does not exist for all of us. But what Google and state, what Facebook and state will have in common is that all of them exert power. Google exert power over us, state exert power over us. But the nature of and scope of that power is different. And friends, the language we use to refer the power used by Facebook on us and the state on us is insufficient. So we have to redefine the very notion of power, because power, which we traditionally identified, say Robert Edal, A has power over B, that idea is no more relevant in the days to come, friends, because we have to invent new vocabularies to describe situations in which someone has power over someone. So this situation is emerging in the days to come. So, friends, of course, we need not to be pessimistic. In the days to come, there will be a supercharged state. There will be a supercharged state. State will become, you know, more powerful than what it is now, because all these technologies, though not invented by the state, are developed under the laws of the state. That's why the present day a conflict between WhatsApp and government of India. Government of India asks WhatsApp company to comply with the national law of India. If you don't comply with the national law of India, you have to quit the country. So state in the days to come will certainly become a supercharged state. So there is no scope for, you know, pessimism also. But friends, what is very important is that we have to change the language of describing things around us. So we have to change the essence of our political concepts, the political ideas, the very notion of liberty, justice, equality, power, freedom. These ideas needs to be changed. because these ideas at present is insufficient to understand, to refer many things around us. So friends, that is all about this lecture on technology is political. You can have questions.